Greetings, all you 99%ers. This is your host, Dr. Jack Rasmus. This is Alternative Visions. All right, the big news of the past week was signed off today by Trump, passed by Congress this Thursday, the addendum to the CARES Act, which was the third congressional bailout. You know, the first was a minuscule $8 billion when Trump thought this thing was going to be gone after 15 people got infected for medical gear. Then $100 billion, the second, quote, congressional bailout bill, mostly for hospitals and medical supplies that they, of course, didn't receive. And then, of course, we got the CARES Act. Was it two, 3 weeks ago, I guess, the CARES Act? Which is $2.2 trillion, which was composed mostly of loans and grants to businesses, small and large businesses. $250 billion for small, $350 billion for small business, $500 billion for large businesses, $600 billion for medium size businesses. Most of this was grants and loans, about half and half. Right? And then, of course, there was the $500 billion allotment for the rest of us. So, $1.5 trillion for businesses and $500 billion for 165 million workers in the form of layoffs. And unemployment benefit boosts, $600 for 4 months. That was only going to last for 4 months. And the $1,200 checks, which most folks haven't even seen yet, which won't even cover first month's rent for many people living in the big cities. That's already dissipated, and they're talking about they need even more now. $500 billion for us and $1.5 trillion for the rest of them, businesses. And then, of course, you had all kind of gaming of the system going on with those business loans. And we'll talk about that. Of course, that wasn't enough. Very clearly, that was just an immediate stopgap, good for four to eight weeks, and they knew that. So what they had to do was pass a supplement here of $484 billion this past week on top of the $2.2 trillion, $484 billion, $320 billion of which go to small business loans. You know, they blew right through that first $350 billion for small businesses in 2 weeks. It was all accounted for in 2 weeks. And that's where a lot of the gaming of the system came in, you know. Companies that were much larger than small business but had small business subsidiaries had their subsidiaries apply for individual small business loans. And you got these big corporation food chains, restaurant chains, you know, like Chris's Steakhouse and whatever. Each individual steakhouse applied for and got loans, and you had even some financial firms, you know, private equity firms that have independent, more or less subsidiary partnerships. They all applied, even though they're sitting on $1 trillion of assets, right? They were gaming the system that way. So they wiped out the $350 billion in 2 weeks. And what they had to do was to allocate another $320 billion and now trying to institute some kind of a oversight and rules so it wouldn't be gamed. You see, the original CARES Act, the $2.2 trillion passed several weeks ago, had provisions in it for Inspector General and for a Board of Oversight. But Trump pretty much said, well, verbally, verbatim said, you know, I'm the oversight. And then, of course, the directives quietly went out to the Small Business Association, or agency, rather, that implements the small business loans. And the word went out, and the money started funneling to Trump's buddies and his favorite industries, right? And mismanagement of it going out. And we'll never know how it was mismanaged as long as Trump's in, because the small business agency of his administration refuses to say who got the loans. Yeah, it's some of them have leaked out, you see. Some whistleblowers are leaking out some of the worst abusing of the lending, small business lending. But we'll never know. The SBA says, well, we're not going to tell you. Not even Congress gets to know. You know, this is all part of the administration governing by executive and ignoring the other branch of government there, the legislative, at least the House, that has authority over moneyed matters. You know, per the Constitution, money matters originate in the House. So Trump is doing whatever he needs to do to keep everybody blind and ignorant of what's going on and the scams that are going on. By the way, there's another scam related to all of these loans, small business and medium, and that is, about roughly half of it are loans, the bailout, and another half are grants, you know, just outright free money, right? And, of course, the loans can convert to grants if the business uses the loan to pay payroll and, utilities and, I think, one other thing, rent, perhaps. It will convert to a grant. Well, most of that's going to convert to a grant. And, you know, how much are they paying for the interest on these loans in the first place? Who knows? I've seen some figures at 1%. Nice loan, 1%, right? It's really free money, $500 billion to $660 billion now, because it's $310 in the supplement bill just passed here to the $350. So $660 billion to small businesses, virtually all grants, right, now or later. And then $600 billion more to medium business. Medium businesses are defined by 500 employees to 10,000 employees. That's a pretty big medium business, 10,000 employees, or $2.5 billion in revenue, right? And then you have the really big corporations on top of that, and they're getting $500 billion. You know, the airlines and Boeing, and, you know, they're getting like $100 billion plus out of that $500 billion directly. But how are they scamming, these loans, and as far as the requirement that they be used for maintaining payroll? Well, there's a couple ways that they're doing it. First of all, like Boeing, they're laying people off anyway. Well, how are they getting around it then? Well, by saying we had all these layoffs scheduled before the act was passed. So, you know, any future layoffs, okay. But all these were scheduled beforehand. You know, and all you need to do is create a back paper trail of some emails to show that you were doing that. So that's how they're laying off workers even and still getting the loans, right? And then there's a lot of big businesses who are so fat on cash, you know, and they had no intention of laying off, but they're taking the loans and saying, oh, see, we're complying with the no layoff. Well, they weren't going to lay off anyway. They just justify it and then take that money that they were planning in their budgets to spend on wages and directing it to some other slush fund that they'll use maybe after a couple months more stock buybacks or pay some, more benefits for the senior management or whatever the hell they're going to do with it, speculate in stock markets and other financial markets with it. So they're getting a freebie to do with whatever they want with it. That's that $500 billion, you see. They don't need it. Most of these big corporations had super profits in recent years, you know, 25-27% profit increases over preceding years for the Fortune 500 companies. You know, most of that given to them by a big freebie and the Trump tax cuts. You know, 22% of the 27% increase in corporate Fortune 500 profits in 2018 was the tax windfall. 2018 tax windfall. So they're fat on profits. And then they drew down all of their credit lines with the banks beforehand. Record first quarter this year credit drawdowns, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars. And then they also issued corporate bonds at a record level in January, February, and March. And that brought in even more cash. So they're sitting on a mountain of cash, these big corporations, and they're still taking the $500 billion. Yeah. And then they're gaming it by lying and playing games, as I said, about payroll, maintaining payroll. And then the small business, of course, you get the change, the big corporate change, who are manipulating that, as I explained. So, you know, it's a river, free money, flowing into corporate coffers, you know, which comes on top of the Trump tax cut free money river, you know, in 2018, which is really $4.5 trillion over a decade, you know, $300-400 billion in 2018 alone. And as I said many times, it's really $4.5 trillion, not $1.5 trillion, because they're not counting in their official $1.5 trillion estimate of the Trump tax cuts. They're not counting the $2 trillion U.S. multinational corporations will reap over the decade, because they're not paying any foreign profits tax now. You know, the territorial tax has ended. So that's not counted in that. And then the $1.5 trillion is an assumption we're going to have 3-4% GDP growth for 10 years. That's what they assumed in 2018 when they passed it. Well, of course, you know, that's absolute total nonsense now. We know it because we have the worst recession since the 1930s on our hands. Blow through that $1.5 trillion revenue that was supposed to come in from that kind of economic growth. So, you know, the assumption $1.5 trillion, it was just nonsense from the beginning to sell it to the public. It was nonsense, and they knew it. Okay, so that was a big windfall for corporations. The big corporations and the wealthy investors in particular got that big windfall. And then zero rates, we drove down interest rates, free money from the Fed. Trump made sure that happened in 2018 and 19. So, you know, these big corporations are getting all this free money from coming, you know, conduits and fire hoses coming from multiple directions. And now, of course, the latest fire hose is the bailouts. Yeah. Taxes, low rates, tax cuts, low rates, and bailouts. We're just showering these big companies with subsidized. The state, the capitalist state, is subsidizing hand over fist corporate America, capitalist America. I'm talking about the medium, big size guys, you know? It's obscene. It's worse than obscene. I can't even find the filthiest word to describe it. All right, so that's what has been going on here. And now, of course, we've added $484 billion to fill up the hole for small businesses who are really getting screwed, as well as the workers getting screwed here. Well, you know, that's what capitalism is about, right? Now, the big guys get taken care of, and they throw crumbs when there's a crisis at the rest. So, you know, what's in this $484 billion supplement, and why is it not enough? And what is coming next in terms of bailout? And what about the success of this bailout? Will it be successful? Will the Fed... Historic experiment going on of bailing out the entire business capitalist sector here really work? And that's exactly what it is. You know, let me digress on the Federal Reserve, the central bank, a little bit. You know, when it was created in 1913, you know, the whole idea was if banks associated themselves with the Federal Reserve, with the central bank, they were potentially able to get bailed out when there was a crisis. If you didn't affiliate with the Fed, well, then you couldn't get bailed out. So big incentive to get, you know, that protection. And most banks, but not all of them, a lot of small banks, didn't join the Fed in 1913. So the Fed was really about bailing out the banks. That's the first thing. So Congress does not have to write taxpayer-funded checks to bail out the banks. Well, what we got now is the Fed bailing out everything on the business side, everything. You know, it was supposed to be only commercial affiliated banks, but in 2008 crisis, the Fed turned to bail out what's called the shadow banks, the financial intermediaries that hadn't joined the Federal Reserve System. Well, these were investment banks, you know, insurance companies, which really are banks, and private equity firms and hedge funds and finance companies, you know, all this parallel banking network, sometimes called the shadow banks, that are big as the commercial banks. You know, commercial banks would be J.P. Morgan and Chase and Wells and Bank America, right? We have two parallel banking systems. One is partially regulated, and that's the commercial banks, where people put their deposits. And then there are the professional banks, where rich people put their money, which are largely unregulated. And that's the shadow banking system. And that's the system that pulled down everything when it crashed in 2008 and 2009. So the Fed had to sort of spread its umbrella over the shadow banking system and bail it out as well. That's 2008 and 2009. But we're still talking about only financial institutions being bailed out. And by the way, the Fed spent $4.5 trillion in quantitative easing and special auctions to bail out mostly the shadow banks and the commercial banks that were sort of got tied in with the shadow banks because they were lending them money. And when the shadow banks went down, you know, Lehman Brothers and Bear Stearns and Merrill Lynch and so forth, when they went down, then they pulled down the commercial bank. So that was the bailout, $4.5 trillion by the Fed. The Fed always bails out the banks. It's not Congress. That way Congress doesn't have to take the heat for using taxpayer money. Well, how do you bail out then if you don't use taxpayer money? Well, you bail out because the central bank can print money. It can make money itself. It doesn't have to use taxpayer money. You know, literally, it's electronic printing, of course. But, you know, the mandate was extended in 2008-09 to bail out the shadow banks. Still, only banks. Now, we see the Fed extending that mandate without even congressional approval. You know, there's a vague, ambiguous clause in the Fed legislation that allows it to interpret pretty much whomever it wants to bail out. And it's done that again, and now it's bailing out non-bank companies. Non-bank companies getting bailed out, you know, of all kinds, everywhere. The Fed is becoming the garbage can for all capitalist debt, you know, and it takes the debt from the companies and it gives them real money, you know, exchanges debt for real money. Puts it on its own balance sheet. Well, already the Fed has committed to $9 trillion and rising in bailout. In other words, in 6 weeks, twice the amount that it took 18 months in 2008-09 to bail out. In just 6 weeks. And it won't be enough, and I'll explain why it won't be enough. It may not even succeed in bailing out the entire capital system now. Because most of this bailout money, you see, approved by Congress, is really an approval for the U.S. Treasury to work with the Federal Reserve Bank to create loans through the private banking system. You know, when you talk about $660 billion small business loans, When you're talking about $600 billion for medium size and another $500 billion for large corporations, that's all going through the private banking system. Yeah, the Federal Reserve provides that money to the private banks, and the private banks, Chase and so forth, loan that money out to the non-bank businesses. We got a funnel, a bottleneck here, and that's the big banks. You know, they like this in the age of 21st century global financial capitalism. The banks are in the driver's seat, politically and economically, and it's all got to be bailouts top down going through their books. So you have this, $1.5-2 trillion going through their books in loans and grants, and they decide who gets the loans first and most. And that was another way the system was skewed and gamed recently. You know, the money went to the big banks, and the big banks said, okay, we're going to decide to give this money first, you know, the $350 billion small business, for example, first through, to our best customers, to our largest and our own best customers, because we know they're our best customers, and they'll pay up. Each loan that's given out by the private banks has a fee associated with it. And who knows what other kind of costs and fees that the big banks, the Chases and so forth, rip off from the total and keep from themselves. I've seen figures of, just the loan origination is 5%. The big banks keep 5%. Who knows what other fees that they've got associated with it. So they skim off the top. The big banks. And it all goes through the Fed, through the private banks, to the non-bank companies out there. You got to understand that. It's not as if Congress is writing a check. Congress is writing a check for the homeowners, for the $500 billion, for unemployment, 4 months of unemployment supplement, and for the $1,200 check per person. That's a direct payment. And you notice that's not going up, is it? Right? But the rest of it is authorization to create treasury bonds to give to the Fed so the Fed can give money to the private banks so they can loan it out to the rest. So all of the debt comes back to the Federal Reserve's balance sheet. It comes back to them. All right, so it's kind of to understand how the mechanics of this bailout really work, right? And now we've got another $320 billion allocated to the Fed here that will supposedly go to small business. And the SBA, the Small Business Agency, just handles the paperwork on this. It's not the SBA that's making the loans, although that might be the case with the $60 billion additional disaster relief. That may be direct. I'm not sure how that exactly works out. So this $484 billion is $320 billion additional small business loans. It's another $100 billion going to hospitals, $75 billion for hospitals to buy supplies that they can't get, mostly, and $25 billion for testing. You know, it's very important before they open up to really do this testing out there. $25 billion won't go very far, but it's something to get to jumpstart the testing, the national testing program. It's turning out that this coronavirus, with far more people have been infected with it and show no symptoms, and they can be infectious, in other words, contagious, even without the symptoms. So people have to be tested. People even who are tested and show that they have antibodies may mean that they still are contagious, walking around, spreading it all to everybody. So people are going to have to be tested multiple times, even if they show they have antibodies. Right? Oh, but, Trump says we got some of these great treatments coming, This hydrochloroquine did not work. We're finding out now it's killing people. Then Trump comes up. I got to say this. This is not economics, but I got to say this. Trump comes up, I think it was yesterday, and he starts talking about Oh, you know what? Why can't we get ultraviolet light? You know, that kills the virus. Why can't we put ultraviolet light somehow inside the human body, right? Or then he says, well, you know, cleaning agents clearly kills them. So, you know, how can we put these disinfectants inside the body? I mean, eyes just rolled on that one. Mm-hmm. I think I'm going to write the White House, and I'm going to tell them, you know, I'm starting up a company, and I have an ultraviolet photon inhaler product. Maybe, you know, Trump might be interested in that, right? Or a microscopic injector that you can put into the bloodstream, and that will leak Lysol, right, as it goes through the bloodstream. Yeah, this guy is damn crazy, you know? He's so incompetent, I can't believe it. Anyway, enough of that. Enough of my commentary on the brilliance of the Prince of Liars, Donald Trump, the clown king. And let's move on to economics and more serious topics here once again. So we have this $484 billion supplement here, right? Most goes to small business. Some goes to disaster relief, $60 billion, and $100 billion goes to hospitals and testing. But it's not going to be enough. It's not going to be enough. And already there is discussion of another bailout bill, which will begin a debate come early May when Congress returns to Washington, D.C., as it opens up. And what are they talking about? Well, what's left out of the $484 billion was a couple prime proposals that the Democrats just caved in on. And one was to bail out the cities and counties, right? Need a bailout. You know, their tax revenues are collapsing as well because people aren't working and businesses are closed. And, you know, police and fire and first responders and people to handle the administrative side of all the programs, special programs that have been created to handle unemployment insurance management, to handle the testing now and so forth. That comes from the states, and they have to hire people and so forth. Where are they going to get the money for this? They're losing all this revenue, and their costs are going up, and of course the state deficits are therefore going up as well. And there's a big fight over that. McConnell pretty much squashed that, forced the Democrats to withdraw that from this latest $484 billion, so that's not in the current solution that. Has to happen at some point. And then the other was food stamps and food aid. McConnell made sure that was taken out as well. He only wants to bail out the businesses, you see. He doesn't want to bail out the rest of the folks, even though, you know, we got, you watch the news and we got these long lines of cars going to the food banks. And I'm sure the food banks are pretty much debilitated here in terms of their stock, and yet, you know, there's no solution to people going hungry here. Remember the administration, Trump had cut 700,000 people off of food stamps here last year, so a lot fewer people, but they don't want to increase that. But they'll increase aid to farmers by $19 billion, you know, in the agriculture bill. Food stamps are in the agriculture bill. They'll give farmers $19 billion, most of which goes to large farmers, on top of the $29 billion they already gave them in the last year because of the a trade war with China. So, the farm sector gets almost $50 billion. And again, most of that goes to corporate farms. And you see the farmers, dairy farmers and others that are just, spilling and, visions of 1930s again, spilling out their milk and plowing under their vegetables and everything, you know, and we're giving them billions to do that. Why doesn't the government simply use that $19 billion to buy the milk, buy the vegetables, and distribute it to people, in the food banks and people who are going hungry? You know, why don't they do that? Why waste that important food that people need, you know? But no, we'd rather give $19 billion to plow it under and spill it in the sewers, right? I mean, what ignorance. I can't believe it, the stupidity of it. Well, you know, that's a quote, our war president, right? He's our war president, right? Yeah, he authorizes the War Production Act and does nothing with it. You know, everything's coming through the private sector. You know, he lines up all these big CEOs at his daily pony show press conference, election campaign videos every day. They're supposed to do all this, the private sector, and we're still waiting. We're still waiting. You know, we have to go buy this stuff from China, PPE and so forth. You know, by the way, why are we buying it from China? Because we offshored the production of all these necessary emergency materials and equipment. We offshored it the last 20 years. We sent it to China. Well, we didn't, but corporations did, and we gave them tax cuts to move to China. And now we're having trouble, right? We don't have the stuff. You know, it's kind of like if we were in war World War II, 1942, and we had offshored the production of aircraft to Japan, right? And now we wonder why we don't have enough aircraft. You know, it's that crazy, really. But it's very profitable for big business to offshore and then get free trade measures passed so they can export the stuff back to the U.S. and not have to pay the tariff, you see. That's what free trade is about, to facilitate U.S. multinational corporations moving offshore, producing more cheaply there, and then sending it back to the U.S. instead of having U.S. workers produce it. That's free trade in a nutshell. What's coming next? What's coming next? Well, as I said, they're already debating. And the Democrats will try to put back in the bill direct aid to state and local governments, direct aid from Congress, you see. Now, you got McConnell opposing this thing vehemently here and even insulting people about it. Well, why is he doing that? Well, because part of the Fed's $600 billion support to medium-sized business includes a bailout of the municipal bond market. In other words, municipal bond, this is where states and cities, localities, borrow money in the financial markets, right? They issue municipal bonds, including, you know, same for state. They call them all muni bonds, right? They issue muni bonds and raise money that way. Well, those investors that put up the money that the states issue bonds in exchange for, right, they are being bailed out by the Fed. In other words, any losses you got, we will pay you for this, the Fed says. So you got to understand, McConnell wants the states to get more in debt, to borrow more in the muni bond market, instead of having Congress give the states a grant, like it's giving grants to businesses, you see. They don't want the states to get grants from Congress. They want the states to go through the muni bond market and get more indebted as a way to raise funds, right? And the Fed will protect the investors that put up the money in the muni bond market. Again, it's everything goes through the capitalist investors, you see. Everything goes through them, and they make money off of everything. That's the preferred way of doing it. That's what McConnell wants. He wants them to go through the muni bond market. which he and the Fed will then protect and funnel more money to free, right? Bail them out, free. So that's a little bit of what the economics, political economy is behind this fight over state and local support. Now, the Fed has already earmarked tens of billions of dollars for the muni bond market, maybe as high as $100 billion, I don't know, that all 50 states are eligible for, and cities with a million more citizens, population, and counties, I think, with 2 million. Okay, so that's the biggest state and local entities, right? But we're finding out now that smaller state and local entities and agencies, you know, like water, utilities, and so forth, are also hurting. So what you're going to see is more money, I predict, in another bill for the Fed to extend its bailout of investors in the muni bond market who loaned, who buy the local government debt for cities and counties of less than a million. Okay, they're going to extend that to less than a million. But it'll go through the Fed, you see. It'll go through the Fed. They don't want direct aid to the states and the cities like they're having and gave a partial concession of direct aid to an unemployment and the $1,200 checks. Well, the $1,200 checks aren't enough. They knew that in the beginning, that it would be 6 to 8 weeks stopgap. And that's going to come up again in the next bill. You know, another further supplement in checks. But this will probably be only checks for the supplement for those who are unemployed. You know, I bet they have some cutoff here. So people who are still working don't get it. It won't be as widespread available to everybody as the $1,200 check provision was or is, right? So that will be debated. Alexandra Ocasio-Cortez voted, the only Democrat who voted against this $310 billion supplement to small business, because there wasn't anything really for the working class, and she's right in that whole thing. They call it, oh, we're going to protect payroll, but I explained how, you know, that's just a selling feature, a marketing feature for the whole program, how they'll get around that. She believes that you need $2,000 a week, you know, on average, at least, to bail out households, and she's true. She's right, you know. And why aren't we doing anything about rents, you know? That could be easily done, you know. The Fed could be given several $100 billion more to backstop the investors who are invested in these apartment complexes, right? Because they're the ones that are holding this up politically and economically. They're holding up, of course, mortgages as well. They don't like the forbearance idea because they think they may not homeowners in forbearance may end up not paying them, so they're not putting their money up for the mortgage industry. So that's what's holding up mortgages, rates not coming down very much. But the same thing exists for the apartment, the renters. You know, a lot of these apartments are owned by these big conglomerates. And, you know, your local landlord's just a manager. He doesn't own these apartment buildings. Congress could easily say, we're going to subsidize for 3 to 6 months, you know, rents. So the renters don't have to pay for 3 to 6 months. The backstop would be for those money bags who back the apartment industry would still get some compensation, or at least half compensation. You know, they'll need to compensate them fully for lost rent. But at least partially, let them have some skin in the game, too, right now. So that has to occur. But no one's talking about renter suspensions or forbearance. And, you know, that would be a better way than giving people direct cash, you know, or at least partly direct cash and partly forbearance. But there's not even talk about the renters going on in this next bill coming. I predict there will also have to be more money for small business. You know, there's what, 7 million small businesses out there with employees? 7 million? And there's millions more who have no employees, right? They're just freelancers. So 7 million, at least, small businesses with employees out there. You know, just do the math here. You know, $300 billion, how far is that going to go? Not too far. You know, and a lot of the small businesses, by the way, are already bankrupt. They're already out of the game. They'll never reopen, and therefore the jobs will never come back. Infrastructure spending, you know, there's no discussion of that up to now. Why isn't there? Right. But Trump wants to cut payroll taxes for workers in the next bill. Now, you probably didn't know this, but the payroll tax has already been cut. Suspended, in other words, for businesses. The payroll tax is half paid by business, half paid by the workers. But in the March CARES Act, the payroll tax was reduced or cut for businesses. They're not paying it, right? Really undermining Social Security, you see, as a result. Oh, but they got that idea from Obama. He's the guy who first introduced a payroll tax holiday, you know, undermined Social Security. You know, there's a $2.something trillion surplus in Social Security. They're calling that down. They're using that, you see, because it's there, which means Social Security will have a funding crisis even earlier than 2034, when it runs out of its surplus and has to cut benefits by 25%. And that's just the payroll. That's just the retirement benefit and disability benefit. I'm not talking about Medicare and prescription drugs, which is also part of Social Security. There'll be a debate over extending the payroll tax cut. By the way, you know, in the first CARES Act, there's a whole host of tax cuts for businesses that isn't being discussed very much. I mean, big tax cuts, and I haven't seen an estimate of how much freebie that will be for businesses. But apart from the employer payroll tax cut, there's what's called the net operating loss, where companies can reach back and get a tax refund for taxes they paid in previous 5 years, and reach forward, not pay taxes now, and pay it later for 5 years, called NOL, net operating loss. That's been expanded and extended for businesses, and there's several other big tax cuts there in the first CARES Act here in March. You know, I haven't seen any estimate of how much that will deliver for corporations. Of course, that will reduce the federal budget revenue source as well, further, and cause even further deficits. By the way, on deficits, the estimate is the deficit this year is going to be $3.7 trillion. Because of all the, you know, the bailouts going on. Well, we were running at $1.4 trillion even before the virus effect hit. Yeah, it was supposed to be the biggest boom year in, you know, U.S. economy, according to Trump, and we're running $1.4 trillion deficit. Yeah, well, why? Well, the massive corporate tax cuts under Trump and hundreds of billions increase every year in defense war spending. That's really what's gouging it. So we were running multi-trillion-dollar deficits under the best of times, and now it's going to be $3.7 trillion. And the bank research, I think Chase Bank Research, says in 2021 it's going to be another $3 trillion. Yeah. So, you know, before this thing is over, if it is, our $23 trillion national debt is going to $30 trillion here in a couple years. $30 trillion. You know, I had predicted last year that even before all this happened, that the deficit, due to the tax cuts and more spending, was going to rise to $34-35 trillion by 2028. Well, hell, we're halfway there in one or two years. No? Well, you know, these huge deficits are going to be used by McConnell and others to really argue against providing more direct aid to households and workers and small businesses, especially the former, and to go after Social Security and cut entitlements and education support and transport and other discretionary spending Congress does. You know, this is going to be the big weapon, and he's going to go after the rest here very clearly. Okay, so continuing here, what else will we see? Well, there'll be a fight over food aid and food stamps again. A fight over in the next bailout bill on workplace safety. It's becoming pretty clear that workers are really concerned in a lot of industries that they're being exposed. And if you don't think they're being exposed, just look what's happening in the meatpacking plants across the country, right? People working very close to each other, you know, shoulder to shoulder in these plants, pork plants, beef plants, chicken plants, right? And they're, well, when the virus hits in that kind of environment, it spreads quickly to everybody. And businesses know it, but they have some of them hope that it wouldn't spread, but it does spread, and then they got to shut down the plant, right? We've got pork and other meat processing plants shutting down everywhere going on. A real threat to the food supply that's in the making, you see. They don't want to publicize that very much because it might cause panic. We have a real problem developing here in food supply and food delivery systems. You know, in the warehouses, Amazon and so forth, workers are complaining that they don't have proper safety equipment. There are wildcat strikes going on all over. At some point, they're just going to put down their tools, people everywhere, and say, hey, you know, me and my family, our lives are more important, and stop working. And then what happens to the rest of us, you know, when there's no food, right? Well, imagine the worst. Hopefully not. But workplace safety, some funding for that and some rules and regulations for that will be debated in the next bailout in May. And then the post office, right? We're looking at the possibility that we'll have to rely more on mail ballots in the fall. And Trump and friends have already begun to counter offensive against mail balloting, you see, and trying to prevent mail balloting. There'll be a real dogfight over that in the fall, you know. Trump is worried that, mail ballots will simply increase the possible votes against them and Republicans. He's probably right. You know, Republican states are everywhere trying to suppress voters, you know, and you give mail ballots, you're just offsetting that suppression. It's going to be a real fight. And I've read even, I don't know how true it is, that even Joe Biden is saying, don't put it past Trump to try to postpone the November election. Well, certainly if there's a second wave, if we open too prematurely and we have a second wave in the fall, which is likely to happen, the crisis will be even worse than it is now. I don't see them, if they open up, ever closing it down again. You know, once they open it up, that's it. They will then absorb all the deaths that will occur. Business does not want to remain closed, most of them. They want to open up. And make no mistake, you know, this open up prematurely stuff is not just Trump's idea. A lot of businesses pounding on his back door to the White House want that. Because a lot of their wealth and their businesses will fail, and they know it. And they would rather keep their businesses than and put up with some increased death rate if necessary as long as they can keep their businesses going. Not all businesses, not all corporations, but boy, there's a lot of them with that attitude. So that's what's really behind opening up prematurely here. What's coming, to summarize, in the next bill in May? More aid to the states, more money to households, probably more money to small business, because, they'll probably go through this second $320 billion in about a month. Payroll tax cut, infrastructure spending, food aid, workplace safety, post office. All that will be debated here in the next bill, but there is a next bill coming. And at the same time, we're going to see the Fed extending its free money loans to various sectors beyond what it has now, nearly $1.5 trillion or more, about $1.7 trillion, I guess. There'll be more extended by the Fed. One area that you're going to see is junk bonds. Already for the first time, the Fed is backing up junk bonds, corporations loaded up with what's called junk debt, high interest rate junk debt, which is really risky and a violation of the Fed rules not to take on loaning money to banks or businesses that are not financially stable. But it's doing it anyway. And the big area that needs the junk bond bailout immediately is the oil and gas frackers, you see. With the collapse of global oil now, less than $20 a barrel, these guys are going bankrupt in the oil patch in Texas and Dakotas, right? And they need to be bailed out. And Trump has said, we're going to bail them out, right? There's some talk of Trump buying their oil, not to put it in the Strategic National Petroleum Reserve, no, not even to do that, but just to buy their oil and leave it in their ground. I mean, come on, that's just a free handout, right? I'm going to buy your oil, but you can keep it. very interesting proposition. Well, where are they going to get the money to buy it? It'll come from the Fed. The Fed will use its, quote, mainstream middle-sized corporate bailout to bail out these companies, but it'll have to add more to it, hundreds of billions more, to bail out the junk bond oil frackers. And, of course, as I said, they'll have to extend a municipal bond bailout to smaller cities and counties. That's coming. Right. And there's some talk that, now they're going to have to bail out nonprofits and universities, you see, with that mainstream $600 billion program. If you add cities, you add nonprofits and universities, colleges, private, right? If you add the oil frackers, that $600 billion, quote, mainstream program will not be sufficient. They're going to have to expand that pretty soon as well. And they will, right? But that'll all come through the Fed and funneled through the private banking system, because it'll be mostly all loans, right? Look at the Fed. What has the Fed done? Well, it lowered interest rates to zero very quickly at the beginning of this thing. If you're a bank, a financial institution, shadow bank, you can come and get zero interest money from the Fed. Threw $700 billion in new QE, quantitative easing, which is where the Fed goes and directly buys up securities itself, bonds, mortgage bonds, and buys up treasury bonds held by private investors, buys them, right? And it's open-ended. QE is open-ended. It's going to continue doing that. It put $1.5 trillion in the repo market. The Fed did, right? And then there's the $1.57 trillion in this CARES Act in March, which it is really providing the financing for. And then another $320 billion here in the supplement to the CARES Act just passed. And then it hundreds of billions of dollars in swaps, currency swaps with other central banks around the world. Now, we give them dollars and they give us their worthless pesos. Right, So we're bailing out foreign banks, you see. Well, that's all for these foreign banks to provide loans to foreign companies and U.S. companies offshore, and so that they can keep buying U.S. exports, you see. That's what that's about. You know, the Fed has thrown trillions and trillions of dollars. You know, as I said at the beginning, it adds up to about $9 trillion and rising to bail it out, to bail out the entire system. The question is, will it work? Will it work? You know, because it's all designed to prevent defaults by businesses, corporations. Defaults are where a business cannot pay the principal and interest on their loans or their borrowing or their corporate bonds, whatever, right? They run out of cash. They can't pay the principal and or the interest, and therefore they default. That's what a default is, a failure to pay the principal or interest on a loan or a debt, right? And when they default, they go bankrupt, you see? They go belly up. They are bankrupt. And when you're bankrupt, oh, that sends a chilling effect across all businesses, a chilling effect, and all financial markets. If it's one individual company here and there, no, it doesn't have an effect. But when you get mass defaults going on in an industry or across an economy, oh, that has a major chilling effect. Banks do not borrow. I mean, do not lend when that happens. Okay, so I guess we're getting a signal here. I thought I had a couple more minutes to wrap up, but, you know, that's the essence of the new loan. The new package, bailout package, and we'll talk next week about the financial fault lines that are beginning to emerge, which may totally negate the Fed's multi-trillion-dollar bailout effort. And these fault lines, U.S. and global, if they aren't contained, will lead to another financial crash, which will make the current situation seem like a dress rehearsal.